Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Welcome to Fusion Church, where we worship both here in the sanctuary and from near and far over Zoom. But wherever we are together as one body of Christ. Before we join in the opening prayer of invocation, I just want to say that we're going to be talking with the elders this week about mask mandates and precautions for COVID and all the questions that have arisen because of the Delta virus and because the students are coming back this week. So at the moment, we are still on the same set of rules that we had before. If you're not vaccinated, please wear a mask. If you are vaccinated, it's your choice, although I would encourage you while you're singing, if you have a mask with you, at least put the mask on while you're singing. But next week, bring a mask with you in case we change things up, okay? With that in mind, I invite you to join me in the opening prayer of invocation that is in your bulletin. May all I say and all I think be in harmony with thee.
God, within me, God, in harmony, maker of the trees.
In me be the truth of stream lover willow, soil giving alder. May all I say and all I think be in harmony with thee.
Thank you.
I have a few announcements for you. First of all, I would like to thank the Board of Elders and all of those who filled the pulpit while I was gone on my vacation. And I want to give a special thank you to Reverend Louise Barger, who has accepted the position as transitional minister starting January 1st. That's 5 months, not that I'm counting. The position of transitional minister is slightly different from the position of an interim minister. An interim minister is pretty much there to fill in the pulpit and other things until you can find somebody. The transitional minister is specifically hired to help the church figure out where it wants to go, what they're looking for in a pastor, and to help them through that process. So it's a 1 to 2 year commitment. Reverend Louise Barger has a wonderful reputation among the American Baptist denomination. My sister is an executive minister up in Rochester, and she's heard of Louise and says she just has, you know, really glowing reports about her. So I think that's a very exciting thing, and I'm very appreciative to the pulpit committee who did all the work in order to bring her here. So that's exciting. January 1st, that's when she begins. As I mentioned, we are going to be discussing whether or not we're going to change any of our COVID practices during we will be discussing during the next week whether we're going to be doing that. So we'll let you know as soon as we can whether or not that's happening. I see some people are already choosing to wear masks while they're here. And so at the moment, that is something that, you know, you might be encouraged to do, but we'll let you know next week whether anything changes. We have a number of things coming up on the calendar. First of all, several memorial services that I'd like you to know about. This coming Saturday, August 21st at 2 p.m. here will be a memorial service for Roger Smith, Sharon Smith's husband, who died just before I went on vacation after a long illness. And so that we're looking for some people to help for the reception following that. There's going to be a short reception in the church center. And because of COVID, it is going to be a light reception. We're going to keep things kind of easy, simple, and short. So we're just looking for some cookies, those kinds of things that you might be able to serve. If you can make any donations of cookies or anything like that, either contact Beth Slack or me at the office or the office and let us know. Also, we may be needing some people to help with setting up, cleaning up and stuff, because some of our fellowship board is gone. Now, Daisy's here, I see you're here. But a lot of the fellowship board is actually not in town. So at this moment, I don't know if we're going to need that, but if you think you could help, let us know or let Beth know so that we know that we have enough people. The same for the following Saturday, that's going to be August 28th. Bill Crandall is going to, they're going to have a memorial service for Bill Crandall. That's at 2 or 3, I'm not sure. It's that Saturday anyway, the August 28th. No, that's the one at 10 a.m. That's the one at 10 a.m., sorry. I have 4 services coming up in the next 5 weeks, so I may get them a little mixed up. So Rogers, next week is at 2. Bill Crandall's is on the 28th, Saturday on the 28th at 10 a.m., and we're also going to be doing a small reception for that. So if you're able to help with either of those, please let us know as soon as possible. On September 4th is going to be Woody Lang's memorial service. That reception is going to be catered, so we don't have to worry about that. I'm not going to try and tell you the time, but put it on your calendar for September 4th. Also, in your bulletin, you'll see the announcement. There's going to be a work day this coming, no, Tuesday, a week from Tuesday, August 24th. Do you want to talk about that?
Yes, we had hoped to have a student volunteer group, and I just got word a couple days ago that due to the Delta variant, the college has canceled the student workday. So I need some input as to whether there are people in the church who are able to help, especially, you know, like washing the windows that haven't been washed for a couple years in the church center is what one of the jobs was. And then John and Lana and I are continuing to paint here in the church sanctuary. So anyone who is up for doing that can talk to one of us, Lana, John, or I. This week, we hope to take out the shelves in the foyer and paint behind them to get that looking a little bit better. You may have noticed there's a change of color on the—
Yeah, John, can you zoom your camera down so that people on Zoom can see?
I thought you should know that we are planning to replace the steps to make them less steep. We will add one stair so that the rise will not be 8 inches, it will be 6 inches, which will make it a little bit less prone for tripping kind of thing. So we hope to have that done as soon as what Dave and his nephew, who are building the steps, are able to get done. Hopefully this week, if everything goes according to plan. So if anyone has any questions or comments or concerns, please talk to me or to one of the trustees about situations, especially here at the church.
And thank you, trustees. Thank you, Laurel, and all the trustees who have done so much work over the summer. Still a lot to do, but at least there's incredible progress being made. Are there other announcements that, let's start with people in the sanctuary, Jan?
Right, the announcement or the invitations for Lori's celebration. We're not saying retirement because it's in October. So we're celebrating 38 years. She began her ministry to us in October, the second week, maybe?
Something like that,
yeah. First or second week of October 38 years ago. So it's great that we can do this in October. And the plan was, before Delta showed up, that we're going to have this early enough so we didn't have to worry about those kind of things. But your invitation will direct you on things that will be happening. They were mailed on Friday. Lori's family and guests are going to be receiving calligraphy invitations. So not to worry, they'll be in the mail, we hope, this week. We're anticipating a wonderful celebration. We're inviting people from early history with Lori and families who may not be able to attend. They may be in Florida or Texas or wherever, but we're hoping that on the back side of the RSVP card, there's a place for comments. So what we're really hoping is that people will write in comments even if they can't attend. So if you talk to any of these people that you know won't be coming, remind them to send comments. We will put these together.
Nice comments.
I don't think I have to. Those will be compiled. And we're going to have about a half-hour program. You'll see that dinner will be served. And then about 7:30, I think time-wise, I think it's 7. We're going to have just a short half-hour program. Not to embarrass her, but to recognize the fact that she has been with us for 38 years and done an incredibly amount of work for all of us. So I wanted to know that these are coming into the mail and you'll notice that they need to be returned by October 1st because we're counting and you have meal choices. It's quite an enterprise. And the committee's been working well. We'll still be working today.
And that's going to be October 23rd.
Yes. So. Did I say?
I don't know if you did, but so you need to get, everybody needs to get a little calendar just for church events coming up in the next few months. Are there other announcements? Anybody in the sanctuary? Is there anybody?
Janelle, I
said. Okay, Janelle, go ahead.
Can you hear me?
Yep.
I just wanted to let everybody know Travis checked in this morning. And he is on the USS Ronald Reagan station keeping. So basically he's in the Gulf and the middle of all the news.
But he did check in and he's doing okay.
Good. Yes.
Good. Thank you.
I can breathe now.
Thank you for letting us know. Are there other?
Okay.
Do you see anybody, Jen? I don't see anybody. Okay, at this point, I'm going to pause the recording. That's new. Will you join me in prayer? God of grace, whose love and comfort we know through your Son, Jesus, we pray to you today, confident that you are present in our need, just as your Son was present in the needs of so many. When we're tired, you lift us up. When we feel that there can't be a way forward, you show us a path that our own eyes were unable to see. We thank you that when we need to be refreshed and believe again in the goodness of the world, that you come to us in the smile of a neighbor, the laughter of a child, the quiet, renewing peace of a summer woods. We're thankful, God, that you bring meaning into our lives and you give us a reason to hope in tomorrow, even when today weighs heavy upon us. You've always been with us, and you've helped us no matter how difficult the road was, and we're grateful, so grateful, God, for the way in which you have graced our lives with moments of joy and possibility, even when everything felt bleak. We ask that you help us to continue to believe in that presence, and that we arrange our lives in accordance with what you know is best for us and for those whose lives are intertwined with ours. May we order our priorities in ways that will benefit those we love. May we make choices that bless our family and our friends. And may we spend our time on pursuits that deepen our hearts and enrich our spirits. May our decisions always begin with a desire to follow your way of grace and goodness, so that every day we are building a life that is worthy of your realm. God, today we pray for those in our congregation, in our community, in our nation, in our world, who are suffering from disease, whose souls are weary with grief, who face loss, personal challenges, financial struggles, whose relationships are in need of healing. We place them in your hands, knowing that you will hold them in your loving heart and be present with them as you have been present with us. Hear us now as we take a moment in silent prayer to think of those who are in need and to bring to you in private prayer our hopes and our fears. Let us pray silently. God, hear these prayers and hear us as we lift our voices as one congregation to say the prayer that Jesus taught us to say. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you. We're just having a few technical difficulties. So we're going old school here and going to start again with the old way of doing things. John, do you want me to? I had muted it before. You think it's all right through there? Before you all start, people in Zoom, was the sound okay on that? Because we were doing it through John's mic. Okay, I will remute myself. Okay.
Thank you. Please join me in the responsive reading. This comes from the book of Isaiah, chapter 61, verses 1 through 7. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me, God has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed, to proclaim liberty to the captives,
and release to the prisoners,
to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor,
and the day of vengeance,
to comfort all who mourn, to provide for those who mourn in Zion,
to give them a garland instead of ashes,
the oil of gladness instead of mourning. They will be called the oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord. Jesus called us to be workers in God's field, sowing generosity, healing, and peace to bring a great harvest of mercy and love. In this time of reflection, may we consider what gifts of resources, time, and commitment we can make to the church so that the ministry of this church will be a growing, vibrant witness to God's love. God of grace, we give to you today as a response to your goodness to us. We ask that you receive our offerings and give us the reassurance of your attention to our needs and the needs of others. May your peace be in our hearts, your grace be in our words, your love be in our hands, and your joy be in our souls. Amen. Thank you.
I'm going to begin a series in which I preach through the major periods of the Hebrew Scriptures. So I'm going to choose a passage from each of the major periods of Israel's history and preach on those. So today we're going to begin with the patriarchs, with Abraham and Sarah. And I'm going to be reading Genesis 18, verses 1 through 15. This is from the Message version. God appeared to Abraham at the oaks of Mamre while he was sitting at the entrance of his tent. It was the hottest part of the day. He looked up and saw three men standing. He ran from his tent to greet them and bowed before them. He said, "Master, if it please you, stop for a while with your servant. I'll get some water so you can wash your feet. Rest under this tree. I'll get some food to refresh you on your way since your travels have brought you across my path." They said, "Certainly, go ahead." Abraham hurried into the tent to Sarah. He said, "Hurry, get three cups of our best flour, knead it, and make bread." Then Abraham ran to the cattle pen and picked out a nice plump calf and gave it to the servant, who lost no time getting it ready. Then he got curds and milk, brought them with the calf that had been roasted, set the meal before the men, and stood there under the tree while they ate. The men said to him, "Where is Sarah, your wife?" He said, "In the tent." One of them said, "I'm coming back about this time next year. When I arrive, your wife Sarah will have a son." Sarah was listening at the tent opening just behind the man. Now Sarah and Abraham were old by this time, very old. Sarah was far past the age for having babies. Sarah laughed within herself, "An old woman like me get pregnant with this old man of a husband?" God said to Abraham, "Why did Sarah laugh, saying, 'Me, have a baby, an old woman like me?' Is anything too hard for God? I'll be back about this time next year, and Sarah will have a baby." Sarah lied. She said, "I didn't laugh," because she was afraid. But God said, "Yes, you did. You laughed." The story of Abraham and Sarah's visitation by angels begins with this sentence. God appeared to Abraham at the oaks of Mamre. God appeared at the oaks of Mamre. Not God appeared at the crab apples of Mamre, or God appeared at the buckthorns of Mamre, or the honeysuckles, or the weeping willows, or the poplars, or the spiny hawthorns of Mamre. But God appeared to Abraham at the oaks of Mamre. When those first listeners of this story heard that Abraham was sitting in the shade of an oak tree, their mind was primed for the possibility that something important was about to happen, because this was not any ordinary setting. Abraham was in the presence of oaks. Throughout human history, oak trees have been prized and revered by ancient people. There are about 600 species of oak trees around the world, and they are all members of the genus Quercus, a name that comes from the Celtic word for fine tree. The Druids considered oak trees to have medicinal and spiritual qualities. The word Druid itself may mean one who knows oaks. In Greek mythology, the oak was a symbol of Zeus. In Norse mythology, it was a symbol of Thor. King Arthur's round table was made from a massive slab of oak. And the Slavic people used the oak tree to depict the very structure of the universe, the roots of earth and branches of heaven. So too in ancient Israel, the oak was a spiritually important tree, revered partly for practical reasons. Oak trees produce copious amounts of acorns, which were an important food source for a nomadic people. And its wood is hard and sturdy enough to resist the teeth of grazing animals that reduced other plants to stubble. If you're having problems with deer in your garden, you might want to plant some oak trees. In Western New York, it's hard to see the oak tree for the forest, but in the barren, rugged landscape of Canaan, oaks stand out against the sky. They could be seen for miles, beckoning the weary traveler to rest in their shade. So God's choice to appear to Abraham at the oaks of Mamre made sense to the first listeners of this important episode in Israel's history. because the rest, the shelter, the provision that was symbolized by oak trees was symbolic of the covenant that God was to forge on that day in the shade of their branches. There beneath the oaks of Mamre, God made a promise to Abraham and Sarah that they would give birth to a nation and their descendants would become a light to the world. And though Abraham and Sarah doubted, though they even laughed at the thought of such an impossible thing, later generations hearing this story knew that God's promise had come true because they were the living proof of that promise. So when they saw the oaks of Mamre, they were reminded that God can do extraordinary things in the lives of God's people. For generations, people would point to those oaks and say, something sacred happened here. If you were to plant an oak tree somewhere in the landscape of your life, an oak tree that said, here is a place where God did an extraordinary thing, where would you plant it? When was there a time when you realized that God had been at work in your world, making what you thought was impossible, possible? Where did you experience holy healing because of the presence of God, or a moment of unexpected grace, a strength that you knew was not your own, a hope that pushed through your doubts and gave you courage to face the next day because you trusted in God to lead you through the wilderness? Those are the places in the landscape of our memories where we should be planting oak trees. Memorials to the promise that God has made to us, that God can bring life out of our barrenness and joy out of our sorrow. Plant an oak tree there in your memory to remind you something sacred happened in that place. When I think of oak trees, I think of a particular stretch of road between Geneseo and Rochester that my family drove every Sunday on our way into church. That was before the construction of 390. So our route took us through the back roads of Livingston County, past innumerable horse ranches and hog farms, the kind of scenery that was unremarkable and tedious to a young teenager, which I was at the time. There was one field, however, that's burned into my memory. As a field itself, didn't have much to suggest it to anybody. It was a hay field, like 1,000 other hay fields in the county. But scattered across its monochrome landscape, each an oasis in the grain, were a dozen or so towering oak trees that the farmer had left deliberately untouched to stand as sentinels over the crops. The oak trees were stunning in their majesty. But more than that, those oak trees mark a moment of spiritual significance in my young life of faith. And I could never see them afterward without remembering what happened one day in their shadow. Just across the road from that field of oaks, there was a dilapidated shack, similar to a score of other poverty-stricken homes sprinkling the back roads of Livingston County. And one winter day, as we drove by that field of oaks on our way home from church, we saw for the first time the occupant of that shack. A wizened old woman was shuffling through the deep snow in her front yard with a load of firewood in her arms. It was quickly obvious that the woman's only source of heat was the firewood in the shed 20 feet from her home, and that the path to that shed was blown over with snow. She moved slowly through the drifts, hunched over from the weight of the logs in her arms, the wind blowing through her thin coat. My father immediately stopped the car, strode through the snow, and gently took the load of wood from her. And for the next few minutes, while we watched, my father carried armload after armload of wood into her house. And when finally he climbed back into the car, he said only, "It seems she lives alone," and then resumed our trip without another word. For my father, his act was nothing more than a simple act of kindness, one I'm guessing he would not have even remembered doing later in his life. But to that old woman, struggling through the frigid snow, carrying her burden, it must have felt to her like an angelic visitation. And it was for me an unforgettable lesson in the meaning of grace. The oaks towering over that stretch of road stand silently in the landscape of my mind, marking a moment when God was made manifest to an old woman and to a young girl as we witnessed the power of grace lived out in a life of faith. Where are there oak trees standing in your memory? Times of unexpected grace, strength you knew was not your own, hope that pushed through your doubts and gave you the courage to face the next day. Where can you look back and think, God was at work in this place. Something sacred happened here. The oaks of Mamre remind us of God's promise, forged first with Abraham and Sarah, and then carried in the people of Israel down to us today, their descendants in faith. God's promise that God is at work in our lives, and God will make possible what we believe to be impossible. God would take Abraham and Sarah, old and barren, and make them the parents of a great race of people. God would choose Moses, a man who could barely string two words together without stuttering, to help defeat a Pharaoh. Through the women, Deborah and Jael, women for Pete's sake, God led an army to victory over the evil general Sisera. And with God at his side, David, the pipsqueak, youngest son of the least of the tribes of Israel, would fell giants and unite Israel as a nation. The prophet Isaiah says, "The Lord has anointed me to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and release to the prisoners." They, the oppressed, the brokenhearted, the captives, they will be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord to display his glory. Here there is an oak tree, Isaiah says, to remind you that God is at work even through these most unlikely people. And the Bible is full of the stories of men and women who showed little promise and had a lot more sin about them than saintliness, people who are honestly like you and me, through whom God brought to birth remarkable things. And in the words of his own son, Jesus, "For mortals, salvation is impossible, but for God, all things are possible." The oaks of Mamre mark the place in the memory of the faithful, not of where Abraham and Sarah strode forth in greatness to save the world, but where God brought salvation in spite of their weakness and in spite of their barrenness. Where are there oak trees standing in your memory? Times of unexpected grace, strength you knew was not your own, hope that pushed through your doubts and gave you the courage to face the next day. Where can you look back and remember God was at work in this place? And in remembering, find the faith to trust that God will be with you tomorrow, continuing to bring life out of your barrenness and joy out of your sorrow. When you remember, you are standing beneath the oaks of Mamre. Let us bow our heads in prayer. God, we thank you for your presence in our life that sustains us and helps us to be more than we ever thought we could be, that brings new life in our barrenness and gives us hope for tomorrow. May we be reminded of your presence in our past so that we can trust in your sustaining presence in our future. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. Deep peace of the quiet earth to you, deep peace of the singing brook to you, deep peace of gentle hearts to you, deep peace of the light of the world to you. Go in peace, now and forever. Amen. Thank you. Those who are on Zoom may stay for a virtual coffee hour, and the rest of you, have a good Sunday.